Welcome to another episode of Mind Matters. Here I talk to Matt Clarke of Milestones, a Manchester four-piece about to release their first full-length Red Lights via Fearless Records. We delve into the power of utilising your personal demons, feeling and embracing pain, and the importance of doing what you love. How are you doing?
Good, how are you?
Yeah, good, thank you.
Good.
Does it feel like a bit of a whirlwind at the moment? Because obviously you've got things coming out, there's a lot of press going on, a lot of people want to talk to you. How are you coping with that general pace of things right now?
I think we've waited for it for so long that it's good. You know, it's not like a pace that we've kind of not been expecting. And especially with how much we've put into this for the past couple of years, now it's a case of like, now's the time where we need to kind of hit the ground running, really. So yeah, we're dealing with it really well. We all enjoy this kind of pace. So,
what about, obviously, when you've got releases coming out, new singles, you have reviews and people talking about the stuff. Are you someone that will go on Twitter and look at the hashtag and check what people are saying? Or do you just wait for them to come to you and just hear the good stuff? Or?
It depends. I used to check everything and then my sanity kind of broke. So now I don't check like Spotify numbers that often. I check like the online statistics and like the analysts and, you know, all that stuff, but I don't check the actual number every single day. I don't check the YouTube views anymore because I notice when it's slowing down and stuff and it does my head in. But yeah, I tend to look at comments more than anything just to see what people think, you know.
And do you ever respond to one if you think there's someone being unjust or saying something that's not true? Do you make a point of replying, or do you just go, okay, there's no point?
Nah, I don't really care. Everyone's got their own opinion, especially in music where it's all subjective. You know, I don't bother with people who don't like the music. It's their choice.
And it doesn't kind of affect you. You don't find yourself at night awake thinking about that comment. You can let it go. Can you shrug it off?
I mean, sometimes I agree with them, you know, like sometimes, I mean, it was like in our last release and someone said, God, that singer's voice is so whiny. I was like, that's true. I do have a whiny voice. And I was like, well, you know, I focused on the next record. This record, my voice has matured a lot. And it was probably partially because I was like, oh, people are noticing things that I notice. Because like, quite a lot of the time, if you're surrounded by people who just kind of yes people, you will say, oh, I've got a whiny voice. Be like, you've got a great voice, shut up. And it's like, I already thought I had a whiny voice. So to hear other people be willing to say it sometimes is a good thing. You know what I mean? Because it means that I was like, there's definitely something there. You know what I mean? And now my voice is, I think, has tonally changed quite a lot.
Okay, so do you think also to keep yourself grounded, it's almost good to have a balance of people going, you're amazing, I love you, and also the people that, you know, bring things into check and go, maybe that could be better, or I think that, and it's not necessarily a positive thing.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. Maybe for most people, I think for me, I need more. I don't know. I kind of think I just have that conversation with myself anyway. I think I've got yes people and harsh critics anyway. Like, I just analyze everything I do. So like, I kind of often will go to people, and if I'm asking for their opinion, I'm usually looking for them to say something more than anything. You know what I mean? I'm more like, I already think this, please reconfirm what I'm thinking. See. You know what I mean? I already have made my decision that that's what I think. But I'll be like, so this song, like, I think we should, for example, Once Upon a Time and Paranoid both actually had an original introduction to them. Mm. They're two songs on our album. And we originally had like 30 seconds. And I kind of like listened to them. I was like, nobody's picking up these songs as the best songs on the record. And, you know, label management and the band, you know, it was just people we were like, I was like, these songs are pretty good. And I already made up the decision in my mind where I was like, no, like these could be singles, but we just need to get rid of that introduction. Right. And I'd already made my mind up. I was like, this is done. This is ready. And everyone was like, no, don't do it. And I was just like, went to them, I was like, sat down, I was like, let's just try it. And by that point, I was just like, you're gonna love it. Like, because in my mind, I could hear it. And then we didn't, now both of them are singles kind of thing.
So that's kind of confirmation, you've got a good gut instinct, you know what you're doing.
I like to think so. Yeah.
It's just nice for people to confirm it sometimes.
yeah. And also, you know, quite a lot of people put me in place quite a lot, which I like. So I've definitely got some people who put me in my place, and I'm the kind of person who needs that, you know.
So you're talking about kind of overanalyzing maybe to an extent. Do you find that's a cause of your, because I saw on Twitter that you suffer with insomnia. Do you think that is a cause of you not being able to sleep because you're going over things a lot in
sometimes.
Your head?
Sometimes. I mean, I don't suffer with insomnia medically. It's not like a, it's just a term that I suppose I must have used, but like one of my friends suffers very badly with insomnia and I don't have anything like that. I think it's just the time zones that I work in. I work mainly nights because the bands that I work with are Australian and American. So like my clock is just a bit messed up. So usually I'll go to sleep. My last call will finish about 2 or 3 a.m. in the morning and I'll wake up about 7 a.m. And sometimes I sleep in and I will sleep till 11 and catch up on my sleep. And then, but my day doesn't actually start usually until about 3 o'clock. When is, you know, the time where I usually start having American calls and stuff like that.
Obviously, as things pick up with this band, you're going to have to juggle things.
Yeah.
How do you think you're going to cope with just tiredness? Because I know when I'm tired, I find everything harder to cope with. I get more emotional. I can't keep myself together. Have you got like a plan in place or how do you think you'll cope?
I think I would deal fine. Like I'd never had sleep that much when I was a kid anyway. I think I'm someone who can function on 5 or 6 hours, but at the same time, I also value and I kind of know when I need more sleep and I just go, right, I'm not going to have that call. I'm just going to give myself some time. Like, I think when I was younger, I definitely kind of would always overdo it and not understand that rest is needed as well. Whereas now I think I'm a bit better at being like, no, it's the weekend. Let me have my time. Like, you know, whatever like that.
That's good that you've got that discipline, because I think a lot of our generation, we're workaholics because we feel like our work is never done.
Yeah.
And we just make ourselves ill all the time.
Yeah, for sure.
Burning out. So that's good that you've got that kind of personality trait.
Hopefully.
Long may it continue. Now, last year you did a lot of traveling. You were touring with a lot of bands and away from home a lot. How did you find being away from maybe what your safety zone is, from what's familiar, your loved ones? How did that affect your mental health in general?
It was difficult. You know, like I had a girlfriend at the time and that was hard. And I had, you know, my mom and my dad and stuff like that. But I think it's always just been something that I knew I had to do. And I think, you know, even though when I was away from people and even my friends as well, I think I'm fortunate enough to have come home and nothing changed. Maybe that's my friends, maybe that's just like my personality with them and my kind of dynamic with them. But like my friends are so good. Like I came back and it was like a welcoming party home. It wasn't like a you've not spoken to us for 6 months. It was like a we missed you. And that wasn't, like, it was great. Like I got a card off one of my friends. Like they were like, they made me a card, which like had like photos of like all the things that I'd done. Like they'd been following and stuff like that. So I'm very lucky to have like very supportive friends. You know, my family were really supportive. My girlfriend at the time was really supportive as well. And it's like, I came home and I felt, you know, happy to be home, but also very comfortable that I could go back. You know,
that support was there, that they're okay with you pursuing this dream.
Yeah, it wasn't like a oh my god, we miss you, never go, you know, go away again. It was a case of like, we're proud of you, we're pleased you did all those things, and we're pleased you kind of were happy doing them. Because I'm so much more happy when I get to see that I'm progressing every single day. And when you're literally in a van with a band playing to fans and gaining people, you can see it. It's like tangible for the first, because you know, you do it online and like, even though we just released this song, it feels like when we're touring, you grow more because you can see it. You can see that you just sold 100 CDs in Las Vegas, you know, and that's like mental. You never thought you'd sell 100 CDs in Las Vegas. So that, I've forgotten the original question, but I went on a tangent, but yeah.
And the thing is, you also see those people in the crowd that perhaps have been gone there for the other bands, and they start to nod their head a bit more vigorously. And that must feel so rewarding for a new band.
Every single day it was like, you know, you're constantly being tested and like looking for the approval of everybody in the room, but you get good at that. Like you know, you'll, as a frontman, for example, when you're in that position, like my job isn't so much as like, how do we make more people sing along? Because nobody in the room knows our words. So you can't make them sing the words, you know what I mean? So my job is more like, I'll be on stage and I'll notice that this kind of little pocket of people are really nodding their heads. and this pocket is. So I'll go over to that area and like make a connection with them people who are already starting to. And I mean, people just like breed interest, like in a crowd. Yeah. Everybody's looking to like, oh, does that, I quite like this, but does that person? And especially in a crowd, you'll go there and I'll like be like, okay, this pocket, and then that grows. Mm. And then, you know, we've got half of a room, really getting into it, half room bored. And that's when I kind of, I'm able to be like, right, well, I don't need to focus on that. I then start making connection with other people.
Yeah.
And it's even just like looking in the eyes and like being like, are you enjoying this kind of thing? And showing that I'm enjoying it, which obviously I am. But yeah, eventually, every single day, it was a case of every single song, more people were nodding their heads until eventually, you know, I'd like to think we did really well at the end of the show.
I saw a lot of positive comments from people that have been on that tour and saying that they met some of you guys afterwards. Mm-hmm. And I think that's quite an important aspect of touring, is nurturing those relationships you start on stage and seeing the people afterwards. Mm-hmm. But you know those days where you almost don't want to talk to anyone and you just want to hide away? What do you do when you know you've got to go and speak to strangers and like mingle and be sociable?
You just kind of have to get through it. Like, I think the support of us as people in the band is really helpful. Like, we've got a very, very special dynamic. Like, people talk about, like, bands being brothers and stuff like that, and it's very cliche, but, like, we are. You know what I mean? It's very much that relationship. In the case of Drew will do my fucking head in one day. am I allowed to swear on this?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, sweet. Drew will do my fucking head in one day, and the next day, like... And that'll be the end of it. Just like a brother, like, he's just like, oh, he's pecking my head in today.
Yeah.
And then the next day, like, he'll do the exactly same thing, but he can tell, like, we've got this, like, unspoken, like, understanding of each other. Like, he can tell I'm not having a good day. Mm. And that's the end of it. He'll, like, notice, he'll do it once. I won't snap at him. None of us snap at each other ever. But, like, he just kind of knows. Like, Drew, for example, I don't know why I'm using him as the only example, but, like, any of them can know when I don't like somebody before I know.
Oh, really?
It's like that. Like, I'll be in a room and I'll just be like, and they just kind of look at me like, you don't like him, do you? I'm just like, how do you know that? And then like the next thing I'm like, oh god, I don't.
They know me better than I know.
Yeah, before. Yeah. So we're lucky enough to have that kind of understanding and very open conversation with each other, where it's like, you've done this wrong, you've done this great, and we compliment each other a lot. And I think that means that when we are having our bad days on tour and we can't socialize, you know, sometimes it's a case of, even though we've got a rule of like everybody has to go out and speak to people because that's important, we want to kind of break down that barrier of like being an artist, we're just people kind of thing. It's a case of like just going like, okay, you don't worry about doing all that, like you just take your time out because you know you're anxious today, or you're feeling really down, or kind of thing. Like, we don't force each other to do things. We're kind of there for each other. So
sounds very healthy and supportive.
Yeah.
Has it always been that way, or has it been a case of trial and error to get to that point, or has it been quite a natural thing?
I think behind the scenes for Milestones, this has been a long slog and a long graft. And I think there's a very strong mutual trust between all of us, knowing that the only people on this earth who knows what we've kind of gone through to get here are each other. And that's like quite... it's a relationship that you don't have with anybody else on the in the world, you know? Because, like, you know, I'm not saying that everything's been bad for the band. You know, they've had fantastic things, but we've almost always been, like, faced with troubles and issues to get there. And it's taken... I mean, we've been doing this for almost 4 years now, and gave up everything for it. So, you know, we're in a place where we understand each other, and we... know that that person is giving up their lives the exact same way you have, so you've got to respect them, otherwise you don't really respect yourself, you know?
Yeah. Is there a sort of a conflict when you're a band that maybe suffers with mental health issues, but you want to be as big as you can be, but you know success will bring more pressures and more things that might exacerbate your issues? Do you have a conflict about growth and becoming bigger and becoming famous?
I think mine's the opposite.
Really?
Yeah, I think I'm driven by... If we're talking mental health, I think my main struggle is a fear of failure, more than anything for me. You know, the idea of like not growing the way that I want to and not having the life that I want to is something that makes me anxious, you know. And that's why I work around the clock and I try and burn myself out to the point where I do burn myself out.
Yeah.
And I mean, I don't try and fight that too much because I know it's quite a healthy thing to have. Like, of all the issues you can have mentally, I quite like it. It's like a big self-motivator for me to want to.
Drives you.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, I mean, I'm the complete opposite, yeah.
I think there's a quote in your press release about your personal demons making them the best person you can be or something like that. Yeah. And is that the case for you? And is that the demon you're referring to? Or is there lots of other ones?
I mean, that's my main demon, yeah. But I mean, I think more than anything, this is something that I've probably learned, you know, more recently than ever, is like, I really enjoy pain. No, not in like a weird sexual way. It's like, you know, no, we're not going there. But like now I don't fear very much ever, because I kind of like think of things as like, well, what's the worst thing that could happen right now? Okay, it's that. Is that a bad thing? Well, yeah, but I can grow from it. And it's like, because I accept pain and like really kind of thrive with pain, I don't victimize myself and go inside and stuff like that. I kind of look at it and I go, well, I'm not scared of anything. There's very little that I'm scared. Obviously, like, there's murder. I'm scared of that. Like, I'm scared of being killed.
That's fair enough.
Yeah, yeah. But, you know, other than that, you know, there's not very much that makes me go, I don't want to go down that route.
That's so freeing, isn't it?
Yeah, it has been. Like, in the past few months, more than ever, like, I've really felt kind of like a maturing phase for myself and, you know, I've been posting a lot about it on social media and stuff like that, and a lot of fans have been taking well to it and stuff, and it's nice to see, because this thing, obviously, like, there's certain things where we should not victimize but like focus and say that was horrible, I didn't like that, and there's certain things that people can never get past, maybe. But you know, we all go through issues in our lives that we can get through. And I think so many people get caught up on it and never move past it. Whereas I'd like to think that if you kind of rewire it and say, well, I'm just going to focus and to tackle everything, you don't become scared of life anymore because of it.
Yeah, I think that's a really positive message to send out. But this talking about it so publicly, obviously, that invites people to join the conversation. Your fans will probably come to you with their own issues, their own problems.
Yeah.
How do you feel about being the person that they go to for this advice and stuff? Is that daunting? Is that scary?
No, I mean, if someone came up to me and asked me my opinion on something, then I'd, you know, more than be willing to listen. I think it's just the kind of thing, you know, like, where it's got to come from you. Like, nothing I say will change anything that you do. It might change you for an hour. It's like when you see a horrible story on the internet where, you know, someone lost a XYZ member of family, and you're like, oh god, like, and then you go home and you give your mum a cuddle, and then but then the next day you're arguing with her again.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, things that you go through kind of thing. Sorry, mum, by the way. You know, the things that you go through and stuff, at the end of the day, if you want to make a change in your life, it's only going to happen because you want it to. I mean, more than anything, I just think it's about, you know, they can look up to people, and I think that's a really good thing to do, is like, have people who they look at as like a way to do it. But at the end of the day, I'm a human. I don't know anything more than them. You know, it's not like I've, just because they look up to me because of my music, that I suddenly know more. I was having this conversation with my grandparents the other day, and, you know, we were saying how we live in a world where people listen to people who have no idea what they're talking about. Like, because the musicians and actors and the people who've got the voice necessarily haven't gone through the things that the people you should be listening to have. So, like, I'd say, you know, I'm more than willing to listen to anybody who's got issues and, like, speak to them and stuff like that, but just because I've got my opinion doesn't mean it's right.
Yeah, it's just your personal experience as well. Yeah. It's not one size fits all thing.
Totally, it's subjective. You know, I mean, life's subjective, but what we go through is subjective, and how we go through it and what we do with it is all subjective. So what will have worked with me is completely different to what will work with somebody else, you know?
So with your mental health, how does it usually show itself with you? You know, it can come in many different symptoms, like sweaty palms, panic attacks, sleepless night. What's the main thing for you?
When I was younger, definitely panic attacks. I've not had a panic attack in years now. I don't tend to suffer. I'm fortunate enough to not really suffer from a lot of the things that I went through when I was younger. I'd like to think it's through, like, the things we've just been talking about, like, dealing with that positively, but I mean, when I was 16, 17, I went through a very, very tough part of my life where I was like quite badly depressed, had a mental breakdown, and I kind of just had to pick myself up from that and find a way to like work out what I wanted. And I think honestly, the way that I got through it was really just making sure that I do what I wanted to do in my life. Mm. And I just kind of realized very quickly that all the things I was doing when I was 16, 17 years old, trying to find myself in the world, it was like, am I trying to find myself, or am I trying to find this carbon copy that everybody wants me to be, you know? And I think if you try and find that person, if you try and find somebody who somebody else wants you to be, you're not going to be happy. Mm. You know, I was back at that age, I was kind of very misled, but very in two minds and not really knowing who or what I wanted to be. And eventually I just kind of said, well, if money was no object, if my parents didn't have an opinion, if, you know, not that they did, you know, it was very supportive, but you still think that they do. You do kind of like take a step back and go, okay, this is what I want. And I'm a million times happier because of it, you know.
So just being actually who you want to be and not what you think you should be, basically.
Yeah, yeah, I mean, I was a huge maths nerd in school, and that's what I was always supposed to be, you know, yeah. Ever since, I think when I was like 5 or 6 years old, my parents got told I was a genius in maths. Wow. I'm not. I'm an idiot at maths. But that labeling kids that early on is just mental. It's like, because I went through school then, and constantly I was like, people were saying, oh, you should be a mathematician. You should go. And I did. It's college. I studied maths and further maths and economics. And it was great because I was good at it, but I didn't like it. Mm. I only liked it because I was good at it. And then, you know, I got worse and worse as I realized I didn't want to do it.
Rebelling against it.
Yeah, well, yeah. That's the thing, is as soon as I hit a part which I didn't actually understand very well, I was like, well, I don't like this. Because, you know, you can only really realize that you like something when you realize you're not good at it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? If you're just good at it, the reason beforehand that I liked it was because it was like, it's easy.
You got good marks and it made you feel good because you got a good mark.
Yeah, and then one day I got a bad mark and I was like, well, why didn't I get that? And I didn't understand what they were saying. And I was like, oh, well, maybe I don't actually like this. And yeah, throughout college, it was when the band started doing really well. And I was like, yeah, that's what I want to do, because my band's not anything big. We were very small and I loved every second of it. So
that's all you need to know, isn't it?
Yeah, it's like, if we can be successful somewhat, then I can, you know, have a semi-successful band. Mm. And also enjoy it. It's like, that's a win-win, really.
Yeah. Now, you've been in the music industry, well, you've been plugging away for 4 years, but I guess the last year has been intensified. From your experience touring and speaking to, you know, bosses and big people in the music industry, what do you think they could be doing more to support people like you, like function better to help people in terms of looking after their mental health and ensuring that they're not a commodity, a product?
Yeah. I don't know what, I feel very supported.
That's good.
In like, our label's very supportive of that kind of thing. It's a very open dialogue. I honestly don't think there's that much of an issue with it, if I'm completely honest. Just because, like, you know, you see bands cancelling tours quite often because, you know, a vocalist or any member of the band tends to be like, you know, I can't do this. Like, I need to take some time out. And I'm sure there was like some sort of like, God damn it, like, are you absolutely sure? Like, is this genuinely too much? But I'm pretty certain that if he was like, yeah, like, I can't do this, I'd like to think that management and label and everybody like that would be like, okay, that's okay.
Mm.
You know? But I think just continuing to do what they want to do, you know, I think more of the issue is kind of our like younger years. Like, I really want schools to teach yoga and meditation and stuff like that. I think that would be amazing. My mum is actually a teacher, and she was talking about how she's like started to do stuff like that with kids and stuff.
That's so good.
And I think that's going to make the world a difference with the issues that we have with growing up and how we're dealing with it, because we live in a stressful world, you know?
Mm.
And the pressures on kids with exams definitely heightens the mental health issues that we have.
Sure. Yeah.
You know, because I don't think as many people, you know, 100, 200 years ago might have had as many issues as we have. I think it's more of a case, like it's, I think it's more of a case of we've put way too much pressure on everybody.
Absolutely. And with social media, body confidence, many issues the kids have to deal with now.
Yeah, because now they've got, not only have they got the approval of their family and the people around them, but they've also got the approval of the entire world, and everybody's watching them all the time. And that's scary. Like, I grew up, thankfully, where I was probably just old enough to deal with that. Mm. But like, my little sister's got two iPads. She was like 8 and she had two iPads, and she's got Facebook and she's 11. I was like, God damn, I didn't know what Facebook was until I was 14.
I wasn't allowed a phone until, like, I was the last person to get a phone. My parents were just so scared of
me. Yeah, I had a walkie-talkie until I was 10. It's fantastic. I'd miss my walkie-talkie.
I'd like that now,
actually. Yeah, yeah. Should we get some?
Yeah, let's
Now, just to finish up, when you feel that you may be about to embark on a kind of bad phase with things, are there any like apps that you turn to, any meditations, any activities that help you kind of get out of that before it gets to the really dark place?
Honestly, no, I just embrace it. Like, if I know I'm going down a downward spiral, I think this is definitely more recently than ever. I think this is a big issue, is like, I don't look at it as like a relapse. Is it a relapse the right word?
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't look at it as that. I just embrace it. I'm like, this is a bad day. Tomorrow I might have another bad day, but that's okay. You know what I mean? Like, and I genuinely do believe our emotions kind of go cyclical, and, you know, kind of like the, as a metaphor, like the phoenix, it like rises, it soars, it falls, it burns, it gets back. And I think that's exactly the same case with all of our emotions and our mental health, not our mental health, but, you know, a lot of the things that we go through in life. So whenever I just go down, I'm just like, well, that's because the past 2 months have been great for me, and, you know, in 2 months from now I'm going to be in the exact same position again. It's just how you grow from it more than anything.
Yeah, I think it's good to feel negative emotions, because you learn a hell of a lot about yourself, whether you've learned to cope with them better, whether there's something that tends to make you feel like that.
Especially if it's a returning thing. It's like, well, why is this returning? Mm. Why am I constantly down about this thing? And then you go, oh, it's because of that. You know what I mean? Like, I think sometimes if constantly the thing that I'm getting down about is different, I'm like, this is great. Like, you know, I'm down about this for a reason. Why is it? Okay, cool. I'll change it. Now I'm better. Mm. And if it was the same thing constantly, that's where I think you've got like something you need to address in your life and make a change, really.
It's like you were saying earlier, we all just want to feel like we're progressing in some way, and that keeps you happier.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I just think like, if you're feeling down, then you should just kind of look at it as an opportunity to rise again. You know what I mean? It's not a, oh my God, I've hit rock bottom, I'm never getting up again. It's a case of, okay, I'm going to make this promise to myself that tomorrow, even though I'm feeling down, what I'm going to do is I'm going to get up at 7 a.m. I'm going to go for a run. I'm going to come back at 8 a.m. and I'm going to get in bed for the rest of the day. And it's like, but at least I've done that thing. You know what I mean? Like, you'll hate every second of it. You won't want to get out of bed. You just want to curl up into like a little hermit stance. But if you just go out and do one thing and then promise yourself that you can be sad, whatever, then at least you've done something, you know?
Yeah, I think that's a positive way to end the interview. So the new album, Red Lights, is out 23rd of February.
Yeah.
Yeah, buy it and download Paranoid.
Yes.
Yes? Anything else you want to say?
No.
No. Bye.
Bye.